Welcome to Planet Lex, the podcast of Northwestern Pritzker School of Law, bringing it to you from Chicago, Illinois.
Hello, and welcome to Northwestern Law's Planet Lex, podcasting from the Northwestern Pritzker School of Law in Chicago. I'm your host, Vice Dean Jim Speta. Joining me today are two members of the law school faculty who specialize in intellectual property and patent law, Laura Pedraza-Fariña, an associate professor of law, and David Schwartz, professor of law and associate dean of research and intellectual life. Thanks for joining me today.
Thanks for having us.
Yes, thank you for having us.
Laura joined the faculty in 2013, bringing a JD from Harvard Law School and a PhD in genetics from Yale University. Probably one of the only law professors in the country with a PhD in genetics, I would think.
That might be true. There's a fair amount of us with a background in science, but maybe not specifically genetics.
Laura joined the law faculty in 2013, bringing with her a JD from Harvard Law School and a PhD in genetics from Yale University. Her research focuses on intellectual property and patent law, and also on international organizations. Her scholarship uses the methodology of history and of sociology in science and technology to interpret the design of patent law. Laura's pieces have appeared in the Northwestern Law Review, the University of Chicago Law Review, the Wisconsin Law Review, and the Berkeley Technology Law Journal. Hi, Dave.
How's it going, Jim?
Dave joined us here at the law school in 2015. His research has a particular emphasis on empirical studies of patent litigation. Prior to his career in academia, Dave practiced intellectual property for over a decade. His scholarship has appeared also in the leading law journals of Northwestern, the University of Chicago, the Michigan Law Review, and the Journal of Empirical Legal Studies. Dave's JD is from the University of Michigan Law School. So you're both featured in the latest issue of the law school magazine, the Northwestern Law Reporter, along with some of our other faculty members who focus on intellectual property, which we think of as an area of strength for our law school. In that article, Laura, I want to come back a little bit to talking about your PhD in genetics. You discuss in the article what inspired you to enter the legal profession as a scientist. Tell us about that.
Yes. You just indicated, I trained as a scientist before actually deciding to go to law school. And I grew up in Argentina, and there the educational system is a little bit different. So you sort of choose what you want to be early on. So ever since high school, you know, I loved sci-fi, loved science. I still love science. So I thought I was going to be a research scientist, a science professor. But when I was at Yale doing my PhD, I was there at the same time that there was this really interesting controversy around patents and university research. And it turns out that Yale had a patent on a drug to treat HIV/AIDS. This was in the 2000s when the HIV/AIDS epidemic was really important, and especially right in developing countries like in South Africa. So there was this issue that people in South Africa did not have access to the drug. And yet, this drug had been discovered at a research university by scientists who, by and large, if you ask them, would say, well, we do want our research to be actually able to cure HIV/AIDS everywhere, right? And so at the time, there was a student group that I was also a part of, which was called GISO, which is a graduate student union. So that's a different story, but I was also part of the Graduate Student Union, a movement to unionize grad students. But as part of that movement, an issue that became important for scientists and certainly became important for me is what happens to the products of scientific research when they leave the lab. Right?
So what's the connection between this controversy and patent law?
Right. So the connection basically is that if you have a patent, right, then the patent is usually held by the university. The university licenses the patent to a pharmaceutical company. And the pharmaceutical company, in this particular case, was selling it at a price that was not affordable for developing countries, right? So this leads to the whole issue of patents on essential medicines, right? And so if we have an essential medicine that could save countless lives, on the one hand, a patent might incentivize the development of the medicine. On the other hand, the patent will certainly curtail access, right? So how do you, and this debate is even more important when you're thinking about universities, right? Because universities have a mandate, right, to do research for the public good. So the short version of the story, just to get to the point of how I got to law school, that I just started becoming really interested in those questions, right? Like, not so much the doing of the research, but the figuring out policies around fostering socially beneficial research.
Pharmaceuticals is one area in which it's sort of easy to see how invention causes social benefit or occasionally causes social harm, but usually we think of pharmaceuticals as causing social benefit. You've done a lot of research on the innovation process more generally, the interplay between scientific social norms and innovation, particularly in your case about how some scientific norms hinder innovation instead of promote innovation. Can you tell us what the relationship is between these norms, what these norms look like, and the innovation process?
Sure. So this research is published and the Northwestern Law Review is actually authored with Stephanie Baer, my co-author at BYU Law School. And we call that research anti-innovation norms. And to understand how some social norms can hinder innovation, you have to also understand a broader debate in the intellectual property community about when do we or don't we need patent law, which goes back to your earlier question. So there's a sort of fundamental assumption when we teach patent law, even to our students, right, that if you did not have patent law, ex ante, there would be very low level of innovation, because copying a product is usually a lot cheaper than researching a product. So if you don't get patent protection, you will have people copying your innovation and you wouldn't be incentivized to innovate in the first place. So our research was part of a broader research by the academic community trying to understand how in some communities that assumption doesn't seem to hold. And you can take all sorts of different communities. For example, the open software movement, right? So actually, a lot of software in the open software movement is not only not patented, but widely shared. So how do these communities arise where it seems that the assumption that if you don't have intellectual property protection, then you wouldn't have innovation? So there's a huge literature in intellectual property suggesting that social norms alone are sufficient to foster innovation. So in the open software movement, you have academic norms of sharing and collaboration. And our research was responding to that and saying we cannot just look at social norms as being pro-innovation. There are some social norms that actually can hinder innovation, and this is a place where patent law or other innovation policies could help you. And we were focusing specifically on social norms that hinder collaboration. So we describe a set of social norms, which we called research priority norms and methodology norms, that make it so that once you're part of a particular community, you will be pushed to frame questions in a particular way, use a particular type of methodology as given by your community that excludes you from looking at problems that may require mixed methodologies or problems that may require the interaction between different communities.
The watchword in a lot of this research and discussion, the watchword is innovation, right? And it's become a watchword in economies generally. Countries always talk about how they want to develop an innovation economy. And even in academia, we are constantly talking about how can we innovate on programs? How can we teach in a more innovative way? Is innovation always a good thing? How do we decide when we have enough innovation? Because innovation takes us away from doing other things.
Yeah, no, that is a really great, interesting and complicated question. Right. If you're thinking about innovation in the context of what else could you do with your time and money, right, then you will think like maximum innovation is not the best outcome, right, if it takes you away maybe from investing in something else. So there's a couple of ways to think about this question. One way is to think, what type of innovation do we want as a society and how can we figure that out, right? There probably isn't a consensus among society members in terms of what types of innovations we should privilege, but there might be a consensus, right, in terms of basic life-threatening diseases. And this is why I think, so for example, we could say, okay, investing in drugs for life-saving diseases is something that there's a generally consensus on. And in the academic literature even, we agree that pharmaceutical companies we want them to exist and we want there to be investment in innovation. It gets a little tricky when you talk about other types of innovations, right? So innovations, for example, do we want to allow Google to innovate, to be able to have better targeted advertisement, right? Is that a good innovation so that we can all get the advertisement that is particularly tailored to our tastes, right? And there is unclear, right? There's a lot of research that actually might decrease democratic dialogue, right? Because we only get to see the things that we're interested in. That is arguably an innovation.
I'm trying to connect this, though, to what I think of, and of course, I'm not a patent law expert, as the sort of fundamental premise of patent law. And let me bring Dave in here. Isn't patent law, though, set up to say the kind of innovations that we're going to get or reward are the kinds of innovations that private companies can make money from?
Mm-hmm. Well, so one thing I want to add to this discussion is that patent law is about giving rights to inventors, rights to exclude others from making and selling and using things in exchange for a disclosure. And we're always trying to balance a few things. One thing that we're balancing is the rights of the kind of pioneer inventor, the kind of first person in a space that we think we might need to give some sort of incentive in order to have them, you know, invest their time and their money on the one hand. And on the other hand, we think that there's actually, once somebody comes up with something, there's going to be a lot of spillover inventions, follow-on inventions, incremental inventions. And sometimes by having exclusive rights held by the first person, by the pioneer inventor, that might negatively affect the kind of follow-on spillover effects that we're seeing, that we sometimes see. And so that's why patent law always has like a very difficult balance to strike. And it's hard to tell whether it's going to work in a particular case and whether we want it to work in a particular case.
How might we go about trying to tell if we can?
Well, that's what scholars try to do. And I think that it's really hard to evaluate, right? Because for a few reasons. One is that, as Laura mentioned, there's all sorts of different fields, and patents might play a different role in different fields, both because we think different fields need more or less incentives, but also just the way that the market works in those fields might be different. And also, this is like a really difficult question, right? There's going to be winners and there's going to be losers. And how do we evaluate as a society whether the kind of net effect is positive?
Right. Yes. And to add to that, going back to your question, Jim, about patent law and the market, the sort of the beauty and the curse of patent law, right? So if you think about it from an academic perspective, the great thing about patent law is the market tells you the direction of innovation, right? So if you are going to innovate and you're going to get a patent as a sort of protection to your innovation, you're only really going to invest in things that you can sell. That could be a great thing, because if we think the market is a signal to people's preferences, then the market is going to guide innovation. That could be a really bad thing in areas where the market fails, right? And the market often will fail for example, neglected diseases or for diseases that only affect potentially developing countries, right? So I think one other way to think about this is to think about what is patent law good at, right? And what are the areas where you have gaps? And so things where you can't sell them in the market, right? There's things that patents is going to be really bad at. Patent is also going to be bad at basic research. So that's one way in which you could think about it. And then on top of it is what David talked about, which is patent law tries to have this balance between incentives and access, but it's hard to know if it gets it right. And there's lots of debates that it doesn't in the area of drugs, for example.
So one thing that I'd like to just add is that there's many different tools that we have to affect innovation policy. Patents are one of those tools, but we can also think there's taxes, there's direct subsidies. So the NIH, the National Institute of Health, provides money to universities directly. There's the regulatory system, and I'm thinking of the FDA. And so each of those have a role. Patents are one component. There's also, to kind of broaden that out, the market has all sorts of other effects. Patents are one small component. I sometimes, you know, there's an old saying that when you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And I'm a patent lawyer and a patent professor. And sometimes I, you know, kind of knee-jerk think like patents are the most important thing. But, you know, that's what my area of expertise is. I'm not sure that patents actually are the biggest component to the innovation system, though.
That's fair. And as a matter of government policy, one of the things you pointed out was the failure, market failure maybe for basic research, for things that can't easily be commercialized. And in an academic setting, grants for research, especially government grants for research, are a big piece of the puzzle. Let me move a little bit from theory to practice. Dave, you've done a lot of research on the empirics and trying to tease out from data answers to some of the bigger questions that we've been talking about, which I find particularly interesting since you were a practicing lawyer for such a long time. What's the connection between your practice experience and the empirical research that you've been doing recently? Why do you find that to be particularly interesting?
So when I was in practice, and I spent over a decade doing intellectual property, focusing on patent law, I had, you know, a number of cases that I worked on, and I was, you know, influenced by, like, what happened in those cases. Like a lot of experienced lawyers, I think I had an intuition on, like, what was important and how the system, how the patent system works, how the patent litigation system works. But I wasn't sure. Because I didn't have, you know, a systematic view. I had the view of the cases that I had worked on, and those cases, you know, aren't randomly assigned to me. And patent cases are notoriously, like, long and complex, and so, like, each one you work on for extensively might take years. And so I think it's useful to step back and to study the system systematically. And so that's what I do now. And when I do that, I'm almost always, I come into it with, like, intuitions and hypotheses, but I'm almost always, you know, surprised by at least something that I find.
So give us an example of looking at a question empirically that has tested or has surprised you, as you say, in terms of what your priors had been.
So I have two examples that come to mind. So one is an experiment that I once did with patent jury instructions. And this was with Chris Seaman, who's at the Washington and Lee Law School. And so at the time that we did this, the Supreme Court was deciding whether to change the standard to find a patent claim obvious, from clear and convincing evidence to preponderance of the evidence. And those are different burdens of proof, just like beyond a reasonable doubt. I think as academics, as lawyers, I think we understand that there's, like, theoretically a hierarchy that, like, beyond a reasonable doubt would be, like, the hardest to satisfy, and then clear and convincing evidence would be the next, and then preponderance is, you know, just over equipoise evidence. That would be the easiest to satisfy. But I wasn't sure that's how it really worked, because I wasn't sure that jurors actually paid attention to, like, small linguistic changes in a jury instruction.
Jurors who aren't lawyers and don't live with these fine distinctions every day.
Yeah, and even more broadly, when we looked at the literature, even outside of patent law, there's been a lot of work done on beyond a reasonable doubt, but none on the other standards of proof. So we conducted an experiment where we, you know, wrote a simple patent dispute and then randomly assigned subjects to getting, you know, different jury instructions. And the only difference was that clear and convincing versus preponderance of the evidence. And as it turned out, the subjects in our study, you know, found that clear and convincing evidence was a harder burden to meet. They, you know, consistent with what you would think, but it was a little bit surprising, the magnitude of the difference. So that's, like, one time that I was surprised that I can think of.
I find that encouraging, to think that the juries are able to follow the instructions and are making the distinctions that we think are important in the law.
Yeah. So, like, as an academic, I think that's important. But I also, you know, I had kind of two competing hypotheses. One is, how would jurors really focus on, I mean, we talk about clear and convincing evidence or preponderance of the evidence, but those both sound like kind of technical legal words. Maybe they're glossing over those in a larger dispute. On the other hand, we live in a world where, like, everybody watches CSI and really is interested in these kind of, like, technical burdens of proof issues. And so, as it turns out, when we ran the study, and, you know, our study was about patents, in this context, they did pay attention, and I think it was a little heartening.
I know this isn't the subject of your study, but you're talking about the jury process in patents causes me to want to ask, this is a highly scientific area. I mean, you referred to the question of obviousness in the instruction, and that is, you can only get a patent where the invention is something that would not have been obvious at the time that the invention was made, or something like that. I'm getting a nod here in the room that my non-patent lawyer
yes,
description close. Is close
it's
enough.
It's a good description.
Do both of you think that juries are a good institution, that they handle these complex scientific questions and patent cases very well?
That is a good question and a hard question, in part because, we don't even really have specialized judges, at least not all the way at the level of the district court. So I would broaden the question to sort of say, to the extent that we think we need technical knowledge, should all of patent law, right, be decided by judges with technical expertise? So now that is not the case. So I'm not so worried about juries, I guess I would say, because I think that you have cases tried to district court judges who know the law, but don't necessarily not the technology. And so if we think that that's appropriate, then I think juries, and I would want to ask David what he's found. But my sense, again, is that juries can be trained on understanding that technology. I have that experience also with my law students who take patent law who are not experts. So I'm not worried about it too much, in large part because our whole system is set up so that we have judges who, at least at the district court level, don't have technological expertise, decide patent cases.
Yeah, so Jim, I think that's an excellent question. Putting on my kind of empirical experimental hat, here's my take on it, is that we'd be interested in two things. How consistent are juries when they, like, if we kept having the same jury or different juries decide the same cases, how consistent are they versus how consistent are judges? And then how similar are the answers? Are juries and judges deciding them in the same way? And maybe we'd want to know if they're different, who's more accurate or who's more correct about that. Unfortunately, it's really hard to study because we don't have any data, because the cases, cases aren't randomly assigned to a jury or a judge.
And they aren't tried multiple times.
And they aren't tried multiple times. Or if they are, there's some sort of retrial, it's probably going to go back to another jury, but you don't switch between a jury and a judge. And so this is something that's like very difficult to get at. And I can imagine, ways, and it's a really important question, that one could try to experimentally get at this or try to come up with a clever design that you could get at this empirically. If you're asking my like kind of personal experience from like being a lawyer for a long amount of time, being a lawyer for a while, I would say my intuition is that juries actually do a good job. And the reason why is because there's, usually 12 of them or 6 of them or some number of them that can like kind of talk things out and have varying experiences, while almost all of the trial judges in the United States have no technical background. And so they're deciding it on their own. And so you're, again, like kind of balancing the kind of wisdom of the group versus somebody that just isn't intimidated by lawsuits and maybe even has handled more than one patent lawsuit.
Well, we'll look forward to the two of you working on that study in the future. But let me ask another question. It's a little off patent law, but it is about studying the results in litigation as it actually happens. Dave, you're currently leading an interdisciplinary team here at the university, which includes folks from computer science, from the law school, from other places, that is looking at what are called the Public Access to Court Electronic Records, or PACER system. And you've just received a National Science Foundation grant to take that data, make it open, and study it in certain ways. Can you tell us a little more about that project?
Yeah, I'm happy to. I'm very excited about this project. So the dockets of federal litigation are currently locked behind a paywall that charges 10 cents per digital page to get access to them. A lot of commercial entities, think Westlaw, Lexis, Bloomberg, have paid for that. But there's a lot of people that would benefit from access to it. And I can think of researchers in law, in economics, in political science, in linguistics. Journalists study the legal system and write articles about the legal system. Lawyers, litigants. And so we have a team that's planning on initially downloading all of the dockets for a set period of time, and then later filling that in with some of the key documents, linking that docket information to other publicly available information about, like, for instance, the litigants. So, like, publicly traded litigants have information that they file with the SEC, information about the lawyers, information about the judges, information about the courts. Make it all free and open, and then build on top of that a front-end search engine that allows people to use kind of natural language, Google-style searches, and download the information that they, need.
These are fundamentally public records, which are not yet fundamentally public. Is that what I'm hearing?
That's correct. That while the court system is open, Congress years ago passed a law that permitted the judiciary to charge 10 cents a page for copies, which made a lot of sense when people went and needed to make a photocopy and ask for the copies of the files, that would offset some of the judiciary's costs. But now that they're all available online and everybody files, the litigants file and the judges generate documents online, it makes less sense. But the administrative office of the court still charges 10 cents per digital page.
So this is going to make a revolutionary sort of new database available. What sorts of questions do you, I know it's early days, but what sorts of questions do you and your team think we might be able to ask of this data once it's structured and available?
So I look at this as such a fundamental new source of data. It's almost like asking like, hey, if we did a census, what questions could you ask? There's a million questions. We might ask whether female judges decide cases more quickly than their male counterparts. We may want to know about how particular companies have fared in the litigation system on a really granular basis. There are kind of so many questions in so many fields because we're doing this for not just patent law. So here we're talking about patent law, but we're this project, which we call NOACRI, the Northwestern Open Access to Court Records Initiative, covers all natures of lawsuits. So
every federal lawsuit.
Every federal lawsuit. And we could take, discrimination cases, securities fraud, patent and copyright cases, as well as all of the criminal matters in the federal courts.
I think this is a cool project. I think you're going to have years and years of work to do on this.
Yeah. And so one of the really exciting parts is that our computer science department is so engaged and interested in participating. And a lot of this, while, it sounds great, building a search engine is not something that's in my skill set, nor in the skill set of other people in the law school. So it's great to have colleagues in computer science here at Northwestern that are so interested and engaged.
Great. Laura, do you think you'll have questions for this database?
Yes, absolutely. So I think that one really interesting thing that David touched upon is the idea of gender and innovation. So that's something that I am interested in pursuing. When we wrote with my co-author, Stephanie Baer, our paper, Anti-Innovation Norms, we sort of had this footnote that said, and other norms that don't have to do with interdisciplinary might have to do with gender, right? So gender norms and innovation is something else that we could take into account. So we are interested in pursuing this further, and this database will be one way which we could interrogate that data. So you could think about more specific sort of gender questions about patent attorneys being female versus male and how that, and you could ask all sorts of different things, right? You could ask about sort of how do they get interrupted, right? So there's Tonia Jacoby, who's another member of our faculty, has done a lot of work on interruptions at the Supreme Court, right? So you could ask questions about gender differences in argument, in particular in patent law. And then other things that we are interested in are things that maybe this database couldn't address. But that's one thing for you guys to think about in the future. It turns out that oral arguments a lot of times are not transcribed. And so that's just sort of an open question. So maybe, another collaboration with a computer science department might be figuring out how to automatically transcribe all our oral arguments, right? Supreme Court oral arguments are transcribed. Other oral arguments are not.
That's great stuff. So let me bring us to a close by coming back to Northwestern, where we started a little bit. The work you're doing, the work that each of you is doing, has these strong interdisciplinary aspects to it. You're working in patent law, but innovation and sociology and history, and this collaboration with computer science and your empirical work is part of what we think we do here at Northwestern. Coming back to the issue of the reporter, which talked about the community here, what's it like to study intellectual property in the environment we have here at Northwestern, and why has it worked for you?
So ever since I joined Northwestern, I've been part of a sort of group in Evanston, which is the Science and Human Culture group, which brings together members of all sorts of different departments. I think I am the first one in the law school to participate. But those departments are history, sociology, other humanities departments, and even some basic sciences department to talk about sort of history and sociology of science issues. And that group has been really, really helpful in sort of helping me formulate questions in the language of history and sociology and become more familiar with that field as I use their insights to reach into patent law. And I've been also part of a group which got a grant from our Buffett Center to study intellectual property and global health. So for the past 5 or 6 years, it's been really great to get to know my colleagues in history and sociology.
And so for me, I think there's kind of two sides to this. One, our students are great. Okay, so it's really enjoyable to teach students like we have, and most of them have work experience, and the ones that are interested in intellectual property oftentimes, and patents in particular, have some technical experience that's really useful in the classroom and useful like when I hire research assistants. And then our faculty, as you mentioned, our faculty is really interdisciplinary overall in the law school. So we have lots of folks with PhDs, and that's particularly useful to me, those that have PhDs in fields that focus on quantitative methods. So whether it's our colleagues that have PhDs in econ or psychology or other fields, that's useful. And then we also just have really other smart colleagues that are interested in doctrine and are really interested in like legal problems. And then more particularly, when I think of our IP faculty, we have just a really great mix of people. Peter DeCola, Matthew Kugler, Sherry Diamond, Matt Spitzer has interest in patents. And then Laura and I is kind of two people doing patents. It's really somewhat unusual for a school to have two people that focus on patents. And so it's useful for the two of us that we can talk about patent issues amongst ourselves without having to like veer out to conferences or get on the phone with somebody. So I think all of this has just been really useful for my professional development.
Well, that's great. And it's great to hear from both of you today. Thanks for joining me. And that's our show. If you like what you heard, please subscribe and rate us on Apple Podcast. I'm Jim Speta, signing off from the Northwestern Pritzker School of Law.
If you'd like more information about today's show, please visit law.northwestern.edu/planetlex or legaltalknetwork.com. Subscribe via iTunes and RSS. Find both Northwestern Pritzker School of Law and Legal Talk Network on Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn, or download the free app from Legal Talk Network in Google Play and iTunes. The views expressed by the participants of this program are their own and do not represent the views of, nor are they endorsed by, Northwestern University, Legal Talk Network, or their respective officers, directors, employees, agents, representatives, shareholders, and subsidiaries. None of the content should be considered legal advice. As always, consult a lawyer.